Thank you. Praise. Hallelujah. I thank you, Jesus. Glory. name of Jesus is so mighty, so powerful, that the devil trembles just at the mention of his name. When you're in turmoil and don't know what else to say, you can say Jesus. And the peace that passes all understanding will come. Hallelujah. I feel like we need peace today. Oh, that only Jesus can bring. We love you. We honor you. Jesus, we bless you. We thank you. Hallelujah.
let's do this. Thank you. Thank you for life. Thank you for breath. Can anybody in here give God a great big thank you for provision? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We've been without, right? Thank you for provision. Thank you for health. Yes, there's so many in here that have been healed. But even if we haven't been healed, thank you for health. Thank you for beyond my means blessing. Thank you for blessing I didn't expect. Thank you for blessing I didn't even ask for. Thank you for goodness and grace. Grace for what? Grace that I can approach your throne of glory with boldness just to talk. Just to hang out. I love the words, and I don't know if it's out of date yet. I haven't checked to see if it's out of date yet. But I love the words the youth come up with to hang out. And for a long time, it's been chill. I mean, if you don't know the word, it's chill. Is it school chill? It might not be. They're still trying to figure out what I'm talking about by this time. But you know what? When are we as a body going to learn just to get in His presence and chill? To get in His presence and the Old Testament says Selah. And it was interpreted over and over and over. And I haven't done the study on it. Forgive me, but I haven't done the study on it. But to meditate. To sit in His presence and, for lack of better terms, I mean, they've still got us whipped in this meditation thing. For lack of better terms, to sit in His presence and just... Come on, close your eyes. Let's take a second. Lord, I want to be in your presence for a minute. Now, this makes me nervous. Good. Your word, Father, says, take those things that can be shaken and shake them up. Take those things in my life that are not anchored down, that are maybe of this world or maybe just junk and stuff, and shake it up in my life. And if need be, Father, take it out of my life. Because the verse finishes, then the only thing that remains in my life is what you want in there and what's anchored. Your word, your spirit. We've been studying with the youth the attitudes that we should be having all the time. Blessed are those who are merciful. Blessed are those who are pure in heart. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst. Not just for wisdom, but for righteousness, which means to be in your presence and to have a right standing. Come on, am I the only one here? To move into His presence and to have this thank you, Lord, mentality. Not this I'm expecting and I'm looking for more and that I'm entitled stuff. Father, I love you. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for your spirit. When Jesus left, He said, I would bring you to comfort you, to lead you, to guide you. Thank you, Father, for your spirit. Thank you for the spirit that is so very thick in this room so many times. I don't ever want to take it for granted. I don't ever want to walk out of this building. Yep, another good service. I know it just as sure as I'm standing here that if Pastor Geraldine was here, she would be walking around this front and she'd be looking up at Trisha, Cindy, and I, and Pastor David. Did you ever go to your anniversary or your birthday party or something like that and you rushed through it? No. Why? Because you spent so much time receiving gifts and thanking people. Thank you for that gift. Thank you for even knowing that I wanted. said it. I don't know where I got it. I don't know where I picked it up. But I give God all the credit for whatever this is. But I'm so glad He gives me what I need and not what I ask for. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you,
Thank you.
church. This is one of the things I love the most. We have a pastor that's not threatened by not having this agenda, or this has to happen by here, or we have to be out by a certain time. I hope you don't have to be out by a certain time, because you're going to be disappointed a lot. But that's okay. Because when this happens, I always look at it this way. I don't know if you guys are very competitive. I know we have a lot of people who don't like to come out of the closet on that. But in my mind, it's something like this. The enemy just got defeated. In a big way. In a big way. I felt it. I don't know if anybody else just felt that just for a second, but I just felt it. Yeah, but I've been around that bush before. Yeah, but guess when you go around that bush and it's the last time? Because there's going to be one time, and I'm not, Randy, you know I love you. You know how I feel about you. You know how much I care about you, and you know how much I believe in you. And I'm looking for that day. It's going to be the final time I ever pray for you. You know what? For me, it was today. And I really don't care how that translated onto the camera to go out on YouTube. I really don't care. Because right now, you know what? Because I know when you get it, you have talent you don't realize. You have gifts you don't realize. And when I was praying for you, the end of the prayer, he hit me so hard because you have people to touch you don't realize. And boy, isn't that when it gets, Can I give you one more? You're going to actually embarrass some people here that know that they should be doing the same thing.
Come on.
Because you're going to have so many people that are be kicking people out of this section, and they're going to have to move. Come on, y'all. That's just one person. With a good friend of mine. When you get it, nobody can touch it. Does it get hammered on?
Yep.
Does it get tested?
Yep.
Can they take it?
No.
It's like being in your sandbox and you have your one toy that nobody knows about and they come take and try to touch it. But it's scriptural because the scripture says to guard your heart. So thank you, Father, for this morning. Thank you for the things that happened that may not be so outwardly showy, change, all that stuff. Lord, I love those seeds that are planted deep. And then when the tree starts to grow and life comes at it, it's not blown away, it's not unrooted, it's just, I believe it's Psalm, the first chapter, planted by streams of living. Things of God, not looking for permission to do things in the world, but finding out, Father, is this what you want in my life? Thank you for this morning. Thank you for this morning. If you get ready to receive our offering to this house, which this is good soil. I can't even describe it. It's soil. Don't sit down. This is the church of the Romans. But my knees are going to be all right. That was just for the older folks. But if we can get our tithes ready for this house, our offerings for this house. Oh, I was going to have been meaning that. You guys like the sign? Yes. Woo! You know, some people are going to sign. I like the fact that the old one's gone almost as much as the fact the new one's up. That's just me. Yeah. We have things that we want to accomplish so much farther than where we are even now. So don't think, well, we got the sign done. I need to back off my gift. No. Let's give obediently, but let's also tithe and offering the way God leads us Amen? Amen?
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for today. Thank you for what you've done by your Spirit. Thank you for what you're going to continue to do. Bless Pastor David as he comes. And Father, bless Pastor Geraldine. I pray that you'd send angels to surround her, minister to her. Equip her, Father, for everything that you have for her to continue to do in her ministry. Thank you for her, Father. Open her eyes, Jesus. Come as they sing. Come give your eyes. Good night.
Hello, my name's David Sears, pastor of Jubilee Worship Center, the best kept secret in Tulsa. Come experience Jubilee Worship Center. Located at 161st East Avenue in Admiral. We'd love to have you come worship with us. Hello, my name's...
Not everything that we have planned on it is for everybody, but you can enjoy everything that happens. In other words, if you don't want to swim, they've got this place that we're going to on the Saturday of the retreat. It's called Tranquility Hollow. It's in Broken Arrow. It's like a little slice of heaven that's been hidden there for all these years. These people lived on this acreage that's absolutely gorgeous, and they decided later in life they wanted to share that with people, so they opened it up and they do different things. So we're going to spend a few hours there that day, and there's air conditioning. You can be in the sun. You can be in the pool. They even have zip lining for the younger ones. That's what I'm going to do because I'm young. And just, it's mainly, I was telling Cindy, I'm like, I know this isn't maybe exactly what everybody wanted, but it's about us being together and getting to know each other better and building our relationships. That's what it's about to me. I want to spend some time with you, okay? And I hope you want to spend some time with me. So, I don't know if it's in the bulletin today, but that Friday night we're going to go to dinner, and then we're going to go see a movie together. And for those of you that want to, we're going to camp out right here at the church and spend the night, okay? Unless somebody with a big house volunteers their home, okay? Then the next morning we're going to go have breakfast, and then we're going to go to this Tranquility Hollow and probably laugh at each other and just have a good time, okay? So I'm really excited. I would really like it if you paid in advance, if you want to. It would just kind of help me get an idea, because the more that come, the less it will cost us on Saturday. So we kind of break it down and give everybody a better idea of what it's going to cost. So there's a sign-up sheet in the back where you can see me to go ahead and pay in advance if you'd like to, okay? So far, it's going to be $16.50 for the Saturday part, okay? And you're kind of on your own on Friday for the movie and dinner, okay? So, and I would love it if you bring a friend. This is not just exclusive to our church. You know, we want to grow. So if you want to bring somebody, they would love this. It's going to be a really fun time. No men, nobody under 18. The guys back there are like, yeah, we're going to come too.
You say you bring a friend. You did not specify.
Okay, now I am specifying. The female gender, please. So Cindy has a few more announcements, and I thank you very much.
You guys can't come, EJ and John. No. I just want to say that you guys look awesome today. Give yourself a hand. You look great. We miss some of you that are here today, and I'm glad you're here. Amen. God's grace and His Spirit is so sweet in this place today. I just wanted to read this. These are devotionals that Pastor David got that we have on the back table. I don't know if you're taking advantage of what we offer. The books are back there for sale where you can speak the word every day over your life. And these, if you don't have a devotional, these are awesome. This one says, the name is Savor Every Bite. It says, my wife, Marty, often tells me, Joe, you eat too fast. Slow down and enjoy your meal. I'm usually done long before she is because she takes the time to savor every bite. I wonder how many of us rush through reading God's word without really savoring it. The psalmist said about it, how sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. That sounds good to me. So rather than grabbing the word on the run just before dashing out the door, it's important to read it at a time and in a place where we can really fellowship with God. Take the time and enjoy savoring the richness of God's word. And then there's a little prayer. Thank you, Father, for the gift of your word. Please forgive us for the times when we rush through reading without taking the time to savor the richness of its meaning. Help us to listen to your voice. Isn't that a neat little thing? You know, sometimes you can look at the Bible, and if you're not really someone that likes to study or likes to read, you're like, you know, you just look at it, you don't know where to start. You just kind of open it, and oh, I'll read that today. But this is a pattern. Even at the bottom, it gives you how you could read through the Bible if you don't have a one-year Bible. So I just want you to take advantage. We have a few of these left through August, and then we have quite a few in the back. We'll be putting back for September, October, and November. They're a quarterly thing. So you guys need to take these, and even if you have a devotional, it's neat to have different things and different verses that maybe you haven't read before. How many know that God's Word is very important, and we need to make it important in our lives? Amen? Can I get an amen on that? Okay, a few announcements. August 11th, which is next Sunday, Don Couch will be here. Pastor Don Couch. And we're excited to have him in our church. We were at his ministry, Vision, Friday night, and you can tell he's really on fire. He kind of had a little bit of a different sound, and I'm really excited for him to come in this house, and I feel like he'll have a prophetic word for us. So, and really every Sunday, but when we have special speakers, we need you to invite people. Who are you telling about Jubilee? We can't touch everybody. The leadership, we need you to touch everybody. Word of mouth is what helps grow the church. You guys are just looking at me like, hey, you, everybody pointed at your neighbor, go, you. You need to open your mouth about Jubilee. Because we have an awesome church, and how are the people going to know about it unless you tell them? Right? Right? Okay. This week, tell someone about Jubilee. Man, I have an awesome church. We have awesome praise and worship and preaching and a youth group and a new college group. You guys know we're starting a new college group called Verge. Because we're right on the verge of adulthood. It's really a young adult class. Because shift happens. They're shifting. Shift happens.
Isn't that good?
So if you know someone, a young adult, because of the statistics, you guys, of that age that leaves the church is like 80%. 80% after they graduate from high school leave the church. We don't want that to be in this body. Amen. That needs to change in our nation. So, you need to, if you know of a young adult in your family or just friends, whatever, tell them. Shift happens. You need to come to Jubilee. And we'll get you on the verge of adulthood. Amen? So, Trisha covered the ladies' retreat. And we all also are doing a back-to-school bash August 21st. It's a Wednesday night at 7 p.m. We'll be doing probably hot dogs, maybe hamburgers. We're going to get the slide and the dunk tank. So invite friends, we're just doing it for the kids. They start school the week before that, so we're trying to get the kids to go to school, hand out flyers, and just get a lot of young people here. So we want you guys to come out and help us. That's not the Wednesday, that we're going to take off. We need you here. We need you to fellowship. We need your help. So August 21st, 7 p.m., back to school bash, and we're going to have a really good time. Amen?
Amen.
You know, there was another song we were going to sing today, but this song, I really feel like the way the Spirit's moving today, people need to be ministered to. And I just thank God for His grace. Because no matter what we're going through, His grace is sufficient for us. So just receive today as we sing this song about His grace. It's unmerited. We did not deserve it, but it's His unmerited favor. Amen.
Knows no bounds. Jesus.
Amen. Amen.
The empowerment. Grace of God is the empowerment to do what you think you can't do. Thank you, Father. Such a special time of worship we've had here today. Thank you, Lord.
Uncle Milton?
Yes.
Can I say something real quick?
Sure.
I know most of you all are aware that my mom's sick, and she's going to be going home to be with God soon. And it's something that we've worried about, and we just need everybody to pray for them. We are afraid that she will pray. And I don't want her to be afraid because she deserves so much better because she's been in so much pain. She's so sick. But we need the peace and to know that she knows that she's going to heaven and she's okay. And because she always talks about it, and we feel like she's scared. We don't want her to be scared.
Tammy, as a point of contact, I want to lay hands on Tammy. She can impart to Renee a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. The Bible says we do not have a spirit of fear. Enemy, one of the greatest things, the Bible talks about this, one of the greatest things Jesus conquered was the fear of death. Because a lot of people have that fear, and they don't have to. I mean, when her last breath is here, her next breath is in heaven, and she'll be totally healed, totally well, and we need her to understand that. So Tammy, you tell her that I said your last breath here is your first breath in heaven, and you'll be totally made whole. Amen?
Amen.
So, Father's a point of contact with Judge Tammy. Lord, we rebuke any spirit of fear. Renee has lived for God. She has the Holy Spirit in her, and the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead will take her right into the portals of heaven, where she'll be totally made whole. Totally happy and rejoicing. Walking through the gates to see my dad, her dad. We thank you, Lord. And we rejoice today, Lord, knowing the victory we have over death. Because Jesus conquered death, hell, and the grave. So we thank you, Lord, that Renee receives resurrection life in her mind today. Resurrection life. So today, Lord, we thank you for it. Strengthen Tammy. Strengthen the family, oh God. As we walk through this valley, we'll come out shouting in the name of Jesus. We will rejoice. Everybody shout, we will rejoice. Praise God. Come on, give God praise. Victory in the name of Jesus. Victory in the name of Jesus. Renee has struggled with this thing for years, and I think she's ready to give it up. She just has that spirit of fear, but it's gone today. I believe God answers prayer.
Amen.
Tammy speaks to her. She's going to receive new life. I talked to Dr. Larry Lee yesterday, and he's going to be with us September the 15th. I just want to make that announcement. He'll be here on a Sunday morning and a Sunday night. And I have asked him, because of the revelation that he has on prayer. I've taught on prayer. I've taught his material. But I told him, I want you to come here and release that prayer anointing. He said, Brother, the Lord's already been talking to me about that in your church. So he's going to come on Sunday morning. He'll be teaching and preaching about prayer. Sunday night, he wants to pray for everybody that's here and release a prayer anointing. Now you say, well, I don't need that. Well, yes, you do. There's an anointing to pray. And we all need an anointing to pray. I know it takes discipline to pray. It takes discipline to live for God. But I'm just telling you today that he will be here. One more thing I want to tell you. Lord bless you. You may be seated. Thank you. He has written a book And when I talked to him, he'd been up most of the night, and he just finished the book. It's called Have a Grateful Day. So the Lord been talking to him about writing a book called Having a Grateful Day. And he said, I didn't use any material. I didn't. Everything he said in this book came right out of my spirit and right out of my mind. He said, thank God, at 62, my mind still works. Because he's a very above average intelligent man. And because of that, sometimes people like that seem a little quirky or whatever. But just receiving as he is, he's a great man of God. I've dreamed for years about making a connection with him. And now that I've made a connection with him, he has grabbed hold of me in this church and won't let go. So I told Geraldine, it's so interesting that for years I would give anything to meet him or go to his church. Now he's calling me wanting to come to our church. God, do it or what? So anyway, I just want you to make note of that. September the 15th, he will be here on a Sunday morning and a Sunday night. Do your best to be here. Bring somebody with you. We're trying to do what I heard him say he told his daughter to do, which his daughter is an attorney in Dallas. And she told her dad, Dad, you're the reason that I win so many cases. He said, what have I got to do with it? He said, you always taught me to do, listen to me, do the best you can, and then a little bit more. Somebody say a little bit more. Do the best you can and a little bit more. So we try to do the best we can around here, and right now I'm going to do a little bit more. Amen. I feel like, by the way, he told me that he was so impressed with our service Sunday morning and Sunday night when he was here, and the time that him and I spent together, we're in the foreword of his book. And he dedicated one chapter and tells them all about our church. So if this book goes worldwide, like Could You Not Tarry One Hour did, we'll be known all over the world. Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, thank you, Jesus. God is so good. You know, when you have a message like I had last week, it's almost, and I've got a word I feel like the Lord has given me for today, but it's almost hard to move on. How many got a fresh understanding about your mind last week when I talked about permanently inked? If you weren't here, we preached about tattoos. Amen. Not the kind that's on your body, because that's just a permanent proof of what? Temporary insanity. But what I talked about was people, and this is a great big problem. They're permanently inked in their mind with the shame of past failure. You've been told you're a loser, you'll never amount to anything, and you can't do any better than your mother and dad or forefathers or whatever, and that's tattooed in their mind and limits them to what they can accomplish because they never have had their mind transformed and renewed by the Word of God that says what? We can do all things through Christ. But anyway, I'm not going to preach that. You want to hear it? Gene, I'm sure he'd get you a CD. Amen. Praise God. Well, I've got 30 minutes. Y'all ready? I'm going to back up and cock this gun and we'll load both barrels on in less than 30 minutes. Amen. I've always been known as fast. I can preach fast. I can do everything fast. Hallelujah. God is good. Father, thank you for your word. I thank you for the anointing over the ears of the people to hear and receive. Somebody said amen.
Amen.
I want to talk about the importance of fellowship. The importance of fellowship. And really what I'm going to talk to you about is a hearing ear. And I was sitting in the Sunday school class this morning and they're walking all over my message. But it's okay because it's like every Sunday, either the Sunday school class or Geraldine or somebody will say something to kind of verify what I'm preaching. Let me read this. It's in, if you have your Bible, I would like you to mark this scripture in your Bible and read it sometime and meditate on it. It's in Isaiah, the 50th chapter, And I'm just going to read the fourth verse. Isaiah 50, verse 4. I normally don't take time to do this, but I want you to mark that in your Bible, or at least write on a piece of paper, Isaiah 50, verse 4. And if you don't bring your Bible to class, I'm going to give you an F. I'm just trying to encourage you. This is your lifeline. This is how you can prove whether I'm preaching the word or not. Isaiah 50, verse 4. The sovereign Lord has given me an instructed tongue. King James says the tongue of a learned man. Tongue of a learned man. To know the word that sustains the weary. He wakens me morning by morning. He wakens my ear to listen like one being taught. Like one, Amplified Bible says, like one being taught as a disciple. He opens my understanding to his will. As Christians, we have a relationship with God. He is our Father, and we are His children. But just because we have a relationship, hear me, doesn't mean that we have the kind of fellowship that God plans and desires for us. When we read, or when you read about the writings of great Christian leaders, we see that there was a strong emphasis on two-way fellowship between the Lord and His people. They wrote about spending time just waiting. Kurt talked about it. Just waiting in the presence of God and listening for His voice. David in the Psalm says, be still and know that. Let me finish. Be still and know that I am God. In the book of Luke, it gives a model for what I've just said. Jesus is the best example of this. Listen to me. Jesus often withdrew to lonely places and prayed. Got by himself and prayed. Although he was the Son of God, Jesus found it necessary to spend time alone with God in prayer to discern what God wanted him to hear, what he wanted him to do, and what he wanted him to say. Jesus said, these words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me, and I only say what he tells me to say. Now, Isaiah is saying here that he opens and wakens my ear to hear. Isaiah was saying that it was the Lord who taught him what to say. Now you understand, Isaiah wrote the greatest book of prophecy in the Bible. They say that the whole Bible is contained in Isaiah's writings. And he's saying here that when he spent time with God, God gave him what to say, and he wrote this awesome book. Words that would sustain the weary. But that only happened because he spent time and learning how to hear and open his spiritual ears. Many, many times in the Bible, Jesus said it, the epistles said, let him who has ears hear what the Spirit is saying. How many of you understand the most important thing we can hear is what the Spirit is saying? Whatever God says to you is truth. Whatever God says to you is the answer you're looking for. We search here and there for answers sometimes, but the answer is listening to what the Holy Spirit says. This is the Word of God, and this is what we go by. But God also speaks to us as individuals. Now, if you hear some word coming to you and it's not backed up by the Bible, you might as well trash can it. Don't come bringing me some thus saith the Lord and it's not backed up by this. Okay? I just want to clear that up. Because some people hear all kinds of stuff and they think it's God and it's their imagination or the devil putting thoughts in their head or whatever. But he does speak to us about individual situations that we're dealing with, and one word from God can change your whole life. Amen. One word from God can solve the problem and change your life. Okay, 1 Samuel 3rd chapter. When Samuel, most of you know the story, was a young boy, one night he was in bed and he thought he heard his teacher Eli calling his name. But verse 7 says, Samuel did not yet know. He did not yet know the Lord's voice. The word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. So his teacher, Eli, instructed Samuel to say, when you hear this voice, you say, somebody say, you say,
yes.
Speak, Lord. Somebody shout. Yes. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Oh, my God. That just, when I read that, speak, Lord, your servant is listening. I have a listening ear. I have an ear to hear what I need to hear from the Spirit. I want my ear open.
Yes.
Amen. I want to hear what the Spirit is saying. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. And he goes on down and gives the story. And then in verse 20 it says, the Lord was with Samuel as he grew up. And he let none of Samuel's words fall to the ground. All Israel came to hear Samuel, to hear the word of the Lord that he had received through, somebody say, fellowship. He had received words through fellowship, and all Israel, praise God, wanted to hear what the servant of the Lord had heard when he said, speak, Lord, your servant is listening, and I will tell and say what you have told me to say, do what you tell me to do, go where you tell me to go, and that way I can have what you want me to have.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. In the book of Exodus, it was through fellowship with God. You'd have to read 33, 34, 35, 36, all those complete chapters to get this story. I'm going to paraphrase it in about 10 words. It was through fellowship with God that Moses received the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments that changed the world and have been the bedrock for the laws of our nation. And he received that having fellowship with the Lord. And also he received the pattern for building the tabernacle. I don't know if we don't understand all that, because he received a plan to construct a tabernacle according to the plan and the pattern that he saw in heaven. He made it on the earth, and it became a type of Christ, death, burial, and resurrection, and salvation. Everything was incorporated in that plan that God gave Moses because he was in fellowship with the Lord.
Amen.
That's big, church. He received that because he spent time with God. He received the Ten Commandments and the plan to build the tabernacle.
Amen.
Oh, glory to God. I could preach and get happy, but I'll carry on. In 1 Chronicles, the 28th chapter, through listening, somebody say listening. Through listening, David received instructions on how to build the temple that his son Solomon constructed. When you read about the instructions that God gave David, David wanted to build the temple. He was a man after God's heart, and he wanted to build the temple himself. God said, no, you're a man of war, shed too much blood, we'll have Solomon build the temple. But God gave David all the plans, all the instructions. All Solomon had to do is do what his daddy told him to do. Because David had spent enough time with God that he received every detail. And not only that, he raised millions and billions of dollars. And then the Bible says he went and got in his personal treasure and put in another $1 million. Oh, yeah, I'd preach with it. Somebody needs to get their personal treasure. Oh, good. used to have a man go to church where he hadn't been here in years, so you don't know who he is. He was always struggling about, he was a good tither. When it comes to offerings or helping pay for a sign or a benevolence fund or something, he just, well, I don't have it, Pastor. And then one day we was talking and he was telling me about how many hundreds of thousands of dollars he had in savings. I said, you know what? Yeah, he said it to the wrong person. Yeah. I said, you know what? God may require you someday to dip into that just a little bit. He may look at you and say, you know what, brother? I have need of some of that money that I helped you get. And you got it stuck over here in this account, and you're looking in your pocket, and nothing in there but some keys. You just Selah. It's just which pocket do you want to give out of? Put God a hammer that just, but you know sometimes. I don't preach much on giving, but the Bible says, give, and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall he give unto you. So you can't outgive God. If you're worried about giving too much, forget it. He is the master giver. I said he's the master giver. That's why he said, you give, and I'll outdo you so much, it'll be good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Because when I give, I don't mess around. I get out of the treasures of heaven. He said he supplies what? All my needs according to his riches in glory. So this is for somebody. I don't know what that, I had no intention to say nothing. But if you're worried about God meeting your needs, you need to go on the internet, which I'm not good at, but I found this the other day because I was reading this book that John King gave me, and this man said, stop what you're reading, go on my website, and punch awestruck. My Lord. He was talking about the awesomeness of God. And it starts with this one little city. And then it starts with a state. And then the United States. And then the telescope keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. And the time he gets through, going past the stars and Milky Way, past the sun, past the moon, and the last most powerful telescope we have is so far out to all you can see is a cluster of light. All the stars. He said, now just tell me, you think God has a problem with your house, baby? Or your light bill, or your groceries, or far as that go, your retirement. God has no problem. He has set up a financial system. Lord Jesus, where did I get off on? He has set up a financial system to take care of his people. But for lack of knowledge, we perish. Or I'll put it this way, maybe you're not perishing, maybe you're doing all right. But for lack of knowledge, you don't have exceeding abundantly above. Oh yeah, Pastor, you're preaching really good right now. Because you can't outgive God. I'm going to say it one more time and I promise I'm through. You give a little, he gives, press down, come on, somebody say, press down, shake it together, run it over. In fact, Jesus came to give us what? Life in abundance to the full, to the overflow. To the overflow. My cup runneth over. My God, help me. God wants to do some blessing in your life. Amen. He just wants you to spend enough time with him to get your ear tuned in so you can have a listening ear, a hearing ear. Don't be just a hearer, but be a doer. But you got to hear before you can be a doer.
That's right.
Amen. You need to hear something. Okay. You say, well, Pastor, that's Old Testament. Well, you shouldn't have said that. And I just picked out a tiny little speck here because that's really all I have time for. Son, you talk about spending time with God and having fellowship and God doing some unbelievable stuff. You just start reading the New Testament. You think it's all in the Old Testament, and I know the great things that happened, fire come down from heaven and lick up the wood and the water and burn up the sacrifice. I mean, I know God was a big God. But hey, how about this? The power of the Holy Spirit, the Bible says, it's not me, this is the Word of God. Read it, Acts 2. The power of the Holy Spirit was poured out on 120 folks who in obedience to Jesus' last words, which said, go wait. Go wait. And I'm going to do something. Woo. You just go wait. They believed him. At least 120 did. He was telling this to 500. Or was that typical or what? He was telling it to 500. But 120 of them got a hold of it. They said, God is about to do something. Because he's told us that we were going to receive power. And they already were saved. He said, you're going to receive some power when I get a hold of you. So they went to the upper room and they waited. 120 of them waited for about 10 days and had, somebody help me, fellowship with God and each other for 10 days. For 10 days they're having fellowship. Trying to get along, not fussing, trying to stay in the unity of the Spirit. Be picking on each other and talking. We got 10 days here. And then the power of God is going to fall. So just hang on. And the Bible says, suddenly. You got that? Suddenly. Y'all didn't think I could still do that. Not dead yet.
Amen.
Because see, when I'm preaching, I don't have any pain. So look out. My back is bothering me, but it's getting better. And better and better and better. Right now it feels really good. Yeah. I guess I'll just preach all the time, then I wouldn't have no pain. Woo! I never feel better than when I'm preaching. Woo! It's the anointing. It's the anointing. Now hear me. I know y'all have heard this hundreds of times and you know all about it, but you really don't. 120 folks in obedience to Jesus' last words waited and had fellowship with God and each other for 10 days, and suddenly there was a loud noise. I don't like it loud. I'm sorry. There was a loud, so I said loud. There was a loud noise. Now, this is my interpretation of Scripture. I know it says rushing mighty wind. One version sounds like it sounded like a windstorm. That's what the Bible said. It sounded like a freight train. Well, there was a loud noise. And not only was there a loud noise, something that looked like a tongue and fire began to rest on each one of them. And the Bible says that they began to speak in a language that they did not know. I would like to learn Spanish. I think we really need to be able to speak Spanish. And I saw on the internet the other day where they have this program. They're guaranteeing you to learn to speak Spanish in 10 days. You see that? New method. I'm going to try that. I'll come up here and I'll hear guys preach to you in Spanish. But you got to understand, there's 120 folks here with fire and wind going on, and they're speaking this language that they don't understand. And people came and said, they're talking in Arab or whatever. And I know they don't know that language. Isn't that amazing? And then you got this group over here that's a bunch of goofballs. And they're just drunk. Peter jumped up and said, oh, no. They're not drunk like you think they are. They may be drunk, but not like you think they're drunk. Because they've been fellowshipping with God. And they done heard some word from God. And suddenly, they got fire. They got a language that they didn't understand. And they were speaking it. And Peter said, don't you understand? This is that which had already been prophesied. God fulfills his word. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, I'm trying to be nice. I don't have this time. So, all I'm saying is that God gave them a power and an ability to do what they could not do. And they did appear to be drunk, or something was wrong with them. There was nothing wrong with them except the power of God had infused them. I have been in services where the power of God was so strong till the people appear to be drunk. There was a young man in our church who had part of the same name I have. His name was Milton. Lord bless him. I got rid of that when I became a pastor. That was my middle name. I said, now I'm David. Shirley and I were talking about that last night. She said, you know, David, who knows what happened when you started going by David? There was a different anointing came on my life when I started calling myself David. Other people called me David. This black lady used to call me King David. I said, thank you. So this man, his name was Milton, many, many times I've been in service with him, Cindy Butler, Patricia Destin. The boy would get so drunk, he would laugh and stagger around, fall on the floor, get up, and just, I mean, it was hilarious. He wasn't by himself. There's a whole bunch of folks acting like that. I've been known to partake of some of that stuff myself. The juice of the Holy Spirit. I know you're listening to me on the internet. A lot of people think that's passed away. I'm here to tell you it has not passed away. I have witnessed it. I have experienced it. And I desire to see it manifested in this house. Amen. Nothing I'd like better than to see all of you folks so drunk that you can barely walk. And just act like... just crazy. Hilariously laughing. And the joy of the Lord filled the house. And people were healed. I've been in those services. I see a boy so drunk. I seen him the other night at Brother Jack's party, Judy Paul's husband. What was his name? Him and I were talking about the day that a lawnmower almost cut his foot off. And of course, they were a little narrow-minded because they wouldn't go to the doctor. So he wrapped the thing up and came to church. And that night, he got drunk. God honored his faith and his ignorance. Not more than the doctor. And all of a sudden, there was a sudden. And this boy took out around and around. They took the bandage off his foot. I'm not kidding you. It was totally healed. There was another lady there that had been battling a huge tumor for months. And I kid you not, she fell out the floor when she was running, and that tumor was gone. So, this thing is real.
Yes,
people can say it's old fashioned, it's passed away, all they want, they come too late to tell this boy, because I've seen it with my own eye. I was, the song says, I was there when it happened, and I guess I ought to know. y'all ain't heard. You got to be an old Pentecost. I was there when it happened, and I guess I ought to know. I came in the back door and I was critical. I said, this can't be real. This is what the song goes. It can't be real. That the way those folks are acting, you can't act like that in church. And the person said, suddenly, it got on me. And I wrote the song, it's real. It's real. The Pentecostal blessing. I know it's real. When you experience it, it doesn't matter what anybody says. You can't take it away from a person that's been there and done that. And I've experienced the power of God in ways that you would not believe. Oh, Jesus. I've seen too many healings. I've heard too many testimonies. And Brother Jack was standing there at his 90th birthday, and him and I were talking to Roger Paul. That was his name. Brother Jack said, I'll never forget it. And I was so shocked that he was there. I mean, it laid his foot open. That blade had laid his foot, half cut it off. He ran around that thing like a crazy man. Jerked that bandage off, and it was totally, not a little bit, totally healed. I'm going to tell you another one you won't believe. Brother Don Abernathy, he was a little out there. But the Lord graced him with an anointing. Hang on, internet folks, hang on. Graced him with an anointing to pray for people get their teeth bit. Oh, Pastor. Now, we would have people get their teeth filled, and it was gone. We would examine their mouth before we prayed for them. We would examine their mouth after we prayed for them, and every tooth in their head would be filled. Now, here's what really made a believer out of me. His teeth were crooked. They were going another kind of direction. While he couldn't afford bread. They were just as crooked as they could be. They looked pretty good, but they were crooked. One night he was preaching. He was preaching. And it suddenly happened. And all of a sudden, he hit the floor. Just fell out, flat on his back. Everybody, we didn't think nothing about it. This is Pentecostal church. Over time, we didn't care. They jumped over pews, fell out on the floor, shouted their hair down, whatever. We just had church. But you couldn't cut your hair. It's about that long. They kept a shout. Hairs are flying everywhere. They had bobby pins. You folks, you ain't seen church. I've seen church. I'm 71, but most of my years were raised in that old Pentecostal church, and I didn't like the rules and regulations, but I loved the Sundays. And the power of God would manifest. 6 weeks revivals. Start at 7, get out at 10, go to work the next day, and run back to church the next night because you wanted to see the glory. With my own eyes, I seen a haze in the house one night. And you stick your hands up in it, and the glory of God covered your whole body. We got so uptown, now the power of God moved like that, it scared some folks crazy. About to run out the back door and say, they're nuts. I knew they were nuts. I don't condone people acting crazy. I'm talking about when the power of God moves that strong, there's going to be some folks acting crazy. And they may not even be in the spirit. They're just acting crazy. But we just got to push more to the side and kept on doing it. I seen the boy run out. He was running. And he kind of lost his balance when he got to the front. And he got about here, and he tripped. And he slid all the way up under the altar bench. I just pulled him out and kept praying for him. Oh, Lord Jesus. Well. Oh, Will Abernathy, I'm sorry. When he came to, I'm serious, well, I knew this man. He was about my same age. When he came to, his teeth was as perfect as any of my girls that wore braces. And Andy's, and everybody, his teeth was perfect. And just as white as they could be. I don't understand that. Don't ask me to explain it. All I know is I was there when it happened, and I guess I ought to know. I saw it. Yeah. It's real stuff. Yeah. When preachers tell about going to Africa and people jumping out of wheelchairs and throwing away crutches and the eyes are open and the ears are open and the leprosy falls off and their skin looks pure. I don't have no trouble believing that. Amen. I believe it. I want it. I desire it. But we're so hung that they ain't. With fear, doubt, and unbelief and criticism and uptown church. I believe in decency and in order, but I also believe in suddenly the power of God can do something. Amen. I'm free. No, I'm not. Ananias, not chapter 9. Saul, which we know is Paul, held a coat while they stoned Stephen. Arrested Christians, put them in jail. He was a partaker of their punishment. Lord began to deal, knocked him off his high horse. What needs to happen to love? He knocked off the high horse. So the Lord told Ananias, that old boy named Saul, I want you to go over to a street called Straight Street. He said, when he gets there, I want you to pray for him. And I'm going to fill him with this Holy Ghost stuff. And Ananias said, well, Lord, I've heard about him. He kills Christians. He kills folks like me. He's what they call a hitman. He's after folks like me. He said, I don't care. I have chosen him. I have chosen him. You pray for him. I'll fill him with the Spirit. And he's going to go through much suffering, but he's going to change the world. And his gospel is what I'm preaching today. Because Ananias was listening. He didn't want to do it. He was listening. He said, okay, Lord, you say so. I'm going to pray for him. When he did, it was a suffering. God not only filled him with the Holy Spirit, he opened his eyes because his eyes were blinded and knocked off the horse. The bright light blinded him. He was blind. So, he will all through the book of Acts. The Bible says one night they were praying and the place was shaken. Now, I don't know if that means the people were shaking or if the building was shaking or what. The Bible says they were praying and suddenly there was a shaking. And when the shaking came, this fire came again. And they started talking in this language that they didn't know. And you go on and on and on and on to the New Testament. It's just over and over and over. Man ride this horse. I mean, in a buggy. On that road. Suddenly, a man was sitting beside him in the carriage. Now, that'd give you... You'd have to be in tune with something. And he said, do you understand what you're reading? He said, no, I need a man to explain it to me. So he went in to preach it. And he preached to him. And he so convinced the man saw a puddle of water. He said, whoa, you, or horse, wherever you're riding. He said, I think I need to be baptized after hearing you preach. They jumped off the buggy, got baptized, and he jumped back over the buggy, and the man was gone. It's in the book. See, y'all don't know less stories in the book than put any novel to shame.
Yeah.
You gotta have a listening ear and hear. Isaiah said, he wakeneth my ear morning by morning to give me a word for the weary. You want a word for somebody that you're gonna meet tomorrow that you can encourage them with? Just spend some time with God. Hang out with the Holy Spirit. Just hang out with Him. How do you do that? In your head. He becomes your thought, which becomes your action. He becomes who you are. Now, I'm going to finish right here. Well, Jesus said that you can know the secrets of the kingdom. But you can have the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of God if you'll have an ear to hear. Matthew 13 chapter, read it. It's in Luke also. He said, you can know the secrets of the knowledge of the kingdom of God if you have an ear to hear. He was answering their questions, why do you speak in parables? He said, because they don't have an ear. So I'm not going to waste my time. I'm not going to waste my time talking to somebody that don't have an ear to hear. But you have ears, he said. And you can hear and you can have the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom. This church exists because as a family, after going through many struggles, we're desperate. We were desperate to hear from God. We lost the old Pentecostal church. What was left of it, what was left of it, they kicked us out because we began to look like you. Calling on this meeting's music. So they get us, I come to church in short sleeves or no tie. Put us out. Left for the fellowship. So, but because of all that, we were desperate to hear from God. Came together as a family. And I said, I don't know what to do, but we're going to pray. We spent over 2 years, every Wednesday night, 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, whatever how long it took. Pray. Hear from God. We wanted to hear God. People would come visit our prayer meetings. Lady, one lady came, had cancer. Lived 6 months from then, God healed. People would come, and this fire of Holy Ghost would get them. Start talking in the language they didn't understand. Thank you, Jesus. We found a little church to go to, went there 3 years, and God said, that's not it, it's not your own. Basically what happened. So he said, so this church exists because we have an ear to hear, and we spent time hearing the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus. I said, I still. This is the secret. Only way that I can preach to you like I have today is because I spent hours listening to the Holy Spirit. I'm not bragging, I'm just telling you, I can't impart anything to you that's effective unless it's something the Holy Spirit has said to me. All this I ponder. You know, you have to take out time to study the Word for yourself, not looking for something to preach. But I ponder in my mind, okay, Holy Spirit. And I had no clue come Friday. I used to panic when that happened, but now I know something's going to happen. They're going to get suddenly. So there was, picked up this article on fellowship. Of course, when I take an article, I turn it upside down, long time out, put David Sears on it. Don't even resemble this. But what I'm saying is, when the Holy Spirit gives you a word, then you can give that word to somebody else and it'll be effective. Whether it's in a grocery store, Walmart, your neighbor next door, who comes to borrow a cup of sugar or whatever, I'm still doing that. I used to do that back in the day. Thank you, Jesus. So, I'm just here today to encourage you to read that scripture in Isaiah 50, verse 4. Put your name in there. Say, the Lord gave David Sears an ear to hear and to receive a word for the weary. An anointed word. That's all you need. You don't need a message. All you need is an anointed word. And all it may be is, you know what? I don't know you. My name's David Sears. The Lord told me to tell you, God loves you. God loves you. If you don't get anything else, if they don't respond, just say, have a good day. Read it today. Or, you know, whatever the Lord prompts you. Just say, we need ears to hear. Okay? I'm sure you can stand up. We've had church. Y'all been prayed for. I pray that you were touched by the power of God today. I pray you leave here and take what you've received. Father, I pray for every person here to have a hearing ear. I pray for every person here to begin to desire to know you in the power of your resurrection. I pray that they have revelation knowledge and understanding and wisdom into the secrets and mysteries of God. Oh God, open our ears, open our mind, that we may hear what the Spirit would say to us, Lord, as a church, as a pastor, oh God. Speak, your servant is listening. Speak, Lord, your servant is listening. You know, when I said that, all I hear is like the Holy Spirit said, yes, and I have many things I want to say to you. That's what came to my mind. I have many things I want to say to you. He's talking to all of us. He wants to say some things to us. He's got answers for your problems that are beyond our understanding. So, Father, I just pray today you open our mind, open our heart, strengthen us in our weaknesses, oh Lord, with your grace. With your grace, as Paul writes to the church, he said, grace and peace, grace and peace, grace and peace. Peter said, it's multiplied through the knowledge of God. Thank you, Lord. I don't want to prolong this service, but I also don't want to miss God. And I'm not saying this is God. I'm just saying that if you need prayer, come up here and lay hands on you. Or anything. I don't care what it is. Anything. Anything. You want prayer for anything. I'll just come in agreement with you. And we'll believe God. And speak those things and be not as though they were. Thank you, Lord. Anything. The Lord has many things.
That's right.
He wants to say to each other, many things. Lord, I pray you open his understanding. This man of God that has stood beside me in the thick of the thin, I pray for his inner strength, God, his inner peace, and the revelation knowledge come to him through the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord, you're constantly chipping away our problems and our weaknesses and our hindrances. Lord, we have a willing heart. We have a willing mind. We present our faculties, our body to you. Heal us, Lord. Deliver us from ourselves. Speak, Lord. Speak, Lord. I know in his ears. Speak, Lord. Your servant is listening. Speak. Order our steps, God, according to your word. In the name of Jesus, I stand here in agreement with each other. And his eyes and his heart to be used in the kingdom shall be fulfilled. As he looks unto Jesus, the author and the finisher. Each day, what God started, he will finish. God started, he will finish. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. I love you guys. I pray your hearts be open, be sensitive to the Spirit. Don't resist, because God's not going to ask you to act stupid like I'm talking about. But if he does, it'll be okay. I promise you, it'll be okay. Anything to hurt you. Everything he does is to bless you. He wants to bless you, not hurt you. God, according to your word, we ask and we believe we receive. We
we leave this place believing that we receive, God. Speak, Lord. Your servant is listening. Servants. We are your servants, God. We humble ourselves under the mighty hand of God.
Lord bless you. Have a great afternoon.